on Radio 3, it's time for this week's Mixing It with Mark Russell and Robert Sandall.
Hello and welcome to another voyage of musical discovery. This week we cruise the blues of John Lee Hooker and John Mayall and splosh through the wild improvisations of turntable maestro Christian Markley. We also check out mad sax man Ian Ballamy's Haunted Fairground and the Georgian composer Cancelli's Seventh Symphony. But first, the warm baritone of Mark Russell.
Well, I don't know what I've done to deserve that, but anyway, here's a good track to kick off with. It's a guitar trio called Les Gauchos Allemands, who, as you might guess from the name, are an Argentinian-German combo. They sound like a slightly folksier version of the Robert Fripp Guitar Quintet, who we played a couple of weeks ago. And they make a big noise for three people. This is from their album Hot Fat Fish, and it's called Shiva's Dance.
Another minute of that. That was a minute and a half of Les Gauchos Allemands, and I think that's the pronunciation. And that track was called Shiva's Dance. That's from their album Hot Fat Fish, and it's available on Possible Records. It's remarkable how they managed to make three guitars sound like a bunch of harpsichords on that track, I think.
It is, yeah. They're an interesting group. They're based in Buenos Aires. They're an expandable group, sometimes up to eight guitarists, and they actually call themselves Disciples of Robert Fripp, which you can pretty plainly hear.
He'll be glad to know about that.
Now, here's a track from the king of French movies soundtracks, Eric Serra. He scored a few Luc Besson films, notably The Big Blue, Nikita, and most recently Besson's big-budget Hollywood effort, Lyon. Now, I didn't particularly like Lyon. It was a rather ludicrous tale of a French hitman in New York falling for a 12-year-old girl. I thought the whole thing was pretty high on style and low on content. But I was very struck by the moody, expansive soundtrack. It's a nice combination of eerie, threatening drones, lively ethnic percussion, and lush orchestration. And it did sound good in Dolby Surround stereo. Here's the opening track from the Lyon soundtrack album called Noon.
Thank you.
the opening track of the soundtrack of Leon by Eric Serra, and that was called Noon, and it's on the Columbia label. This soundtrack album actually reminds me of another great soundtrack, Peter Gabriel's Passion album, which was the soundtrack of The Last Temptation of Christ.
It reminds me of that. The musical elements are very similar, but it doesn't quite have the tragic gravitas of Passion, does it? I mean, Passion is an immensely moving piece of work, and I don't think that this really has quite the same kind of emotional scope.
Well, of course, Peter Gabriel actually went back and reworked the Passion album. It's not the strict soundtrack, whereas this one is. Yeah, I agree, it hasn't got the depth, but it's the best thing about the film.
Now for a bit of Black Dog. You must have come across the name by now. Why? It even features on the Mixing It CD, where Björk's anchor song is given a remarkable Black Dog remix. But who or what are they? Well, they're the musical division of Black Dog Productions, an East London-based multimedia company formed in 1989 to showcase the creative efforts of Ken Downey, Ed Handley and Andy Turner. Rather like Pewter Sound of London, the Dogs are bent on dismantling the barriers between visual and audio art. And when they aren't surfing the internet or backing up their hard discs, they make wonderfully evocative, largely improvised electronic music, which avoids most of the clichés of techno, ambient and bedroom DIY. It's fashionable to describe this kind of thing as a journey through sound, but with Black Dog, that's exactly what you get. Sounds and melodic fragments unfurl in a tantalizingly indirect way. From Black Dog's recently released second album, Spanners, this is Further Harm.
Oh!
Black Dog with a track called Further Harm from their album Spanners, which is on the Warp Records label. I really like the lightness of that track. I mean, it's very 80s-y, especially with that sort of arpeggiated octave bass line and those light machine drums. It sounds like Kraftwerk.
Yes, and especially those funny squiggly noises they put in. That was very Kraftwerk-y. It's got a nice sense of humour, that track, I think.
Well, it's not serious at all, unlike a lot of the other people.
It's interesting. Black Dog, who did the remix on our CD of Björk's Anchor Song, are actually back in the studios working with Björk at the moment. Apparently she's planning to use them on her next opus, so that should be an interesting, fruitful collaboration. Now for something much, much older. John Lee Hooker is one of the last surviving links between modern rock and the Mississippi blues, which of course helped to inspire it. He was born in the Delta, moved north in the 1940s, and played with just about every blues legend you can name before becoming a legend himself, and then drifting into a career twilight of polite reverence and genteel poverty. Since 1989, though, things have been looking up for Hooker. In that year, he released The Healer, the first of his 50-odd albums to have had a proper recording budget. And now, with his 75th birthday imminent, he's back with Chill Out, another glossy production studded with contributions from rock star admirers like Carlos Santana and Van Morrison. The best tracks on Chill Out, though, are the ones which feature him on his own, growling, groaning, stamping on the floor with his foot, and making his guitar sound like some ancient percussive device. And here he comes now with Deep Blue Sea.
Let's get this one down, and then I'm going to call it a day.
All right, John.
Raining here and storming on the deep blue sea. Raining here, raining here. Out on the deep blue sea, storming so hard. Rain and rain, rain, rain and rain. Storming on the deep blue sea. I wanna go home, wanna go home. All the planes are drowning. I called the airport this morning. He said, Johnny, we ain't gonna fly till about 3 or 4 days. We ain't gonna fly, ain't gonna fly. The jet's about 3 or 4 days. You know, it's raining so hard here, so hard here. And it's storming out on the deep blue sea. My baby, I said, baby, please don't cry over me. I call my baby, honey, please don't cry over me. I said, raining here, raining here, it's storming out on the deep blue sea. I'm so lonely for you. I'm so lonely, baby. I'm trying, trying just like you. It's raining here, raining here, raining here. It's thrown out on the deep blue sea. I talked to the captain. So Johnny, we gonna be over here, we over here. Another 3 or 4 days. I told the captain on the pilot too. We ain't gonna fly, ain't gonna fly. About 3 or 4 days. Weather's so bad, so bad. Weather's so bad, so bad. All the planes are drowning. All the planes are drowning. All the plane the ground, on the ground. You know, all the plane in the ground. We can't fly, we can't fly for 3 or 4 days. I want to go home so bad. Put the plane in the ground.
Thank you.
Not one, but two senior citizens of the blues there. First, there was John Lee Hooker with Deep Blue Sea from his album Chill Out, which is available on Virgin. And then, a real surprise this, John Mayall's new album. This is called Spinning Coin. That was the title track. It's on Silvertone Records, and a complete revelation to me, because I'd imagined John Mayall had pretty much sort of disappeared with the passing of the 1960s and all those great blues guitarists he brought on. But this Spinning Coin, I think, is better than any of those Blues Breakers albums he put out 20-odd years ago.
What has he been doing?
Well, he's been carrying on, and he's still obviously got a really good ear for talented musicians. I mean, the band he's put together on this album is as sharp, especially rhythmically, as any of those legendary, as they now are considered to be, bands in the 60s with Eric Clapton et al. And this was certainly one of the most pleasant surprises I've had this year.
Now, Ian Ballamy was a founder member and sax player in that seminal jazz big band Loose Tubes back in the early 80s. He went on to form Earthworks with Bill Bruford and that other fellow Loose Tuber, Django Bates. Now, after four albums with them, he's just released a solo album, All Men Are Men. He's joined by an excellent trio of British jazzers, Django on keyboard, Steve Watts on double bass, and Martin France on drums. And they play a selection of Ballamy compositions on this album, including this one, Haunted Swing.
really like the dreamlike quality that track has. That's Ian Ballamy and his quartet and Haunted Swing from the album All Men Are Men, a pun we must point out, All Men Are Men, as in Amen, get it? And that's available on the B&W music label.
I must say, I was slightly disappointed by this album. I found it a bit bland and muted. He's definitely a great sax player, but I just felt the overall sound, it didn't sort of explore anything.
It does drift slightly towards cocktail jazz, but I think in its more exploratory moments, there's more to it than that. And it's beautifully toned, I think. I mean, the layering of the sounds is always pleasing.
Well, here's something I wasn't disappointed by. The latest symphony by perhaps my favourite contemporary symphonic composer, the 60-year-old Georgian Gia Cancelli. Now, it's extremely difficult to pigeonhole the Cancelli sound, but here are a few pointers. He's obviously polystylistic. His latest Seventh Symphony has quotes from Georgian folk songs, big band music, and Beethoven. There are Ligeti-like tone clusters, and there are huge symphonic bursts reminiscent of Shostakovich. But the overall experience of listening to a Cancelli symphony is far greater than the sum of its parts. It's a fairly exhausting roller coaster half hour. Now, the problem for us is that his seven symphonies are all one movement works coming in at around the half hour mark. So taking an extract is slightly problematic. You don't get the broad sweep of the piece with all its symmetries and references. But I figure hearing some is better than none. And so here's the final 8 minutes or so of his massive Symphony No. 7, subtitled Epilogue. And if you're listening on headphones, let me warn you now, don't touch that volume control, as there are some pretty extreme changes in dynamic level. the end of Giacancelli's Symphony No. 7 called Epilogue. And if you don't know Cancelli's music, this CD is actually a good introduction to it. You get two symphonies, the Symphony No. 6, and it's all beautifully played by the Tbilisi Symphony Orchestra, and it's on the Sony Classics label.
Explosively played by some of those horn chords he was getting together in the middle.
Yes, it's fairly massive sounding. If you'd like information on any of the tracks we've played tonight, send a stamped addressed envelope to Mixing It, BBC Radio 3, Broadcasting House, London W1A, 1AA, and the details are on CFAX page 652 until Friday.